Good morning to everybody. Today we will be discussing not our regular the themes. I was asked to discuss with you on academic writing. Basically this morning and this afternoon I will be discussing on academic writing, how to really do an academic paper, and what are the characteristics of it, you know, that sort of thing. So it is not really any philosophical matter we are discussing today, but we are discussing fairly technical thing, okay? So tools for academic writing and methods for reference. How to really do academic writing, and then as scholars, one of the key things we are doing is writing papers. Also, you write in your examinations, and then maybe later you will be writing books, articles to academic journals. So therefore, what we call writing, and particularly academic writing, is something very important part of your life. Okay, so it is important for you to know how to do that. Now, there are many kinds of writing. Depending on the purpose, writing takes different shapes. Now, basically what we do is we read books, and then we think, and then we produce, we write. Usually we write papers, okay? Now, writing to produce reports, descriptions, summaries, instructions, lists, etc. Although they are important, it's not academic writing. They are forms of descriptive writing. Now we see many types of writing in our day-to-day life. For example, in a newspaper, basically what you see is news. So that is reporting. Reporting means you try to say what happened. So that is basically reporting. Of course, in the newspapers, there are other types of academic articles and you know, other things also. But basically in the newspaper, what we do is we report. Now, reporting is to observe what is going on and say what happened. Yeah, that is basically reporting. So in a newspaper, you have reports. And then descriptions. We describe something. If you take any commercial product, there's a small piece of paper in that, describing how to use it, you know, what are the specifications, what are the ingredients, and things like that. So when you buy something, when you buy a watch, when you buy another thing, always there is a piece of paper. So those are kind of instructions, okay? And also descriptions. And sometimes we write summaries and instructions, what to do and what not to do, that type of things. And we make lists. So all these things are different types of writing, but they are different from what we call academic writing, okay? Now, it does not mean that we have to give instructions, we have to provide lists, summaries, descriptions in an academic paper. In academic paper also, we have to do some of these things, okay? But academic paper is something more than that. When you read academic paper, you will find some list. But academic paper is not only a list, it has some more. Academic paper can have explanations, okay? But it is also something more. So academic paper can have some of these aspects, like summaries, descriptions, list and things like that. But plus, we also have something more. Academic activities and scholarly activity. Academic writing is done in order to prove, or in order to support, or in order to establish a point. In other words, in academic writing, we argue in order to support a point. Thus, in the academic writing, an argument is a very important aspect. Now, in an academic aspect, academic writing, basically we write in order to prove something, in order to establish something. I mean, in order to say something, okay? Now, basically, when you read the paper, at the end of the paper, if somebody asks, what does it say? Then you must be able to say in few words, okay, this is what it says. And then the other person will ask, how does the writer support it? What is the argument? Which means you can say something and then you have to also give a reason to support what you say. Okay? You have to give a reason. So therefore, academic writing basically we do in order to prove something, in order to support something, in order to establish a view. And we argue in order to support a point. We present an argument in order to support what we want to say. Now, if you say something without any argument, then that is only a statement. You can make a statement. But the important issue is in academic field, simply because somebody says something, we don't accept it. You have to say why. What are the reasons? Okay. Now, that is very important aspect. Sometime in our daily life, we can say, okay, don't do it. If the person is elderly person saying us, okay, we listen to it. We will not do it. But we will want to know why. Okay, don't do it, but why? Then you have to give some reasons why you should not do it. Do you see the point? So you can make a statement, but then for that statement, in order to support that statement, you have to give reasons. In other words, you have to answer the why question. Somebody says, do this. You ask why. Somebody says, don't do it. You ask why. Somebody says, it is good to do this. You ask why. So give reasons is a very important thing, okay? Now, usually in the examinations, what you get is, you get questions like, okay, explain this, explain this. Then, you know, you basically try to explain something, describe something. But real academic writing goes beyond explaining, okay? Basically, in an academic writing, we try to establish, prove something. Now, I don't know whether you have debates here, but in a debate, we usually take, there are two sides or more sides. So in a debate, you take one side and you support that side. How do you support it? By giving reasons. You know, we can argue whether democracy is good or bad. So one can argue that democracy is not good. The other can argue that democracy is, you know, the bad. Good or bad. Now, when I say that, okay, democracy is good, I have to say why. So that is the part of argument, reason, okay? So academic writing is a scholarly activity. Academic writing is done in, it is done by scholars in order to prove, support or establish a point. In other words, in academic writing, we argue in order to support a point. Thus, in the academic writing, is an argument is a very important aspect. So we are looking at how to do academic writing, okay? Now, I will come to this aspect of argument shortly. In an academic essay, there are three things to be considered: the structure, content, and style. So when we are talking about academic writing, we have to look at three things. One thing is the structure, second is the content, and the third is the style. Okay? Now, structure means when you write an essay, the essay has a structure. Essay has a plan. So we do it according to a plan, according to a method. Okay? So that is the structure. And then content means when we write an essay, we have some subject matter. For example, suppose we are writing on paticca samuppada, causality. So then the information on that subject is what is called content. Okay? The structure means how it appears, plan. Okay? Content means what you are putting into that. It is something like you take a cup. Cup is like the structure. But inside the cup, you have maybe tea. So that is the content. And then the style means how do you present it? The style. Now, when we are, you know, wearing something, there's a style for it. When you are wearing your robe, there is a way to do that. Right? You just can't do it here and there. There is a method to do that. So you have a cloth, you have a way to dress your cloth. You wear your cloth, you have a way to dress your cloth. That is the style. Now, maybe you have a cloth, but you don't have a style. So then people look at and laugh at you. You put your robe here and there. No, there is a proper way to do that. Okay? Now, it is exactly like that in writing. You have a structure, you have a content, and then how are you going to present that content? Okay. There is a proper, particular, accepted ways of presenting a content. Okay. So, we have to think about, in an academic writing, a structure, okay, and then content. Content is the academic part of that. And then the style. The style is not really the academic part, but of course how you present it. But that is also very, very important. When you want to buy something, you look at how it has been packed. If the packing is not very good, we don't feel like buying that. Right? So the packing has to be good and nice and neat. Like you take a telephone, it has to look nice. Isn't it? Pen or book you are writing. So the packing is very important. That is what style means. How it looks. When you write something, it has to be, you know, there must be some order, some way to do that. So that is not really the academic content, but of course, academic matter has to be presented in a certain manner. So that is what we call a style. So we will be looking at a structure and also style. Actually, content is what we learn, what we study every day. Now, in other days, I was discussing with you ethics. I was discussing with you world religions. Now, those things are what we call content. So then I can ask you to write on Christianity, or Buddhism, or Islam. So for that you have to have a content. So that content you can get from listening, taking part in the lectures, by reading, and in all these things, going to internet and so on. But then how are you going to present that? So that is the important thing. So therefore we have to have, we are talking about a structure and also content and style. In the structure of an academic essay, there is a beginning, there is a middle, and there is an end. These three are the same as introduction, body of the paper, and the conclusion. Now, if you roughly look at academic writing, then in a paper you have beginning, middle, and end. So basically we have, the, when we talk about the structure, now if you think something like this, okay, we have a conclusion, we have a beginning. So this is what we call, we say, introduction, and then this is conclusion. In the middle, of course, you have what we call content. This is really the main important part of that. So the, when we talk about the structure, so there is a beginning. I mean, there is a way how to begin it. And then there is what you do. And then there is how to end it, middle and the end. Now, these three are introduction, body of the paper, and conclusion. Okay, so any academic paper, anything, you have to have these three things. Even if you write to an examination, sitting in the hall, and then you write an answer to a question. Now, when you write an answer to the question, you have to, there is a way to start it, and then you write it, and then there is a way to conclude it, isn't it? You can't just write something. You write and then you say, okay, according to this, this and this and this. So you conclude it. And then you start in a manner. In the beginning you say, in this I am going to do this. And then in the concluding section, again you see whether you have done that. Okay. Sometimes we begin by saying, okay, I am going to do this. But at the end, you have not done that. You have done something else. You start by saying, I'm going to go to Mandalay. But to see that you have not gone to Mandalay, but you have gone to somewhere else, Sagaing or something. Then what happened is, you promised to do one thing, but you have not done that. Okay? But it is very important at the beginning, you know, we say, okay, this is what we are going to do. This is what I am going to do. And then you do that. And then finally you say what you did, your conclusion. Now, in this structure, you know, this is something very important. Whatever you write, maybe you are just writing your examination. Or you are just writing a paper to be published in a journal. Now, in any event, or you may be writing a book, you have this thing. Now, in order to see this, sometimes you can look at some books. In a well-written book, you always have an introductory chapter. And then at the end, you have concluding chapter. So, introductory chapter, concluding chapter, and then in the middle, you have other chapters. That means there is a beginning, there is a middle, and there is an end. Okay? So, usually that is how in a book. But any writing we do, any paper we write is also like writing a book. We have introductory section, we have the middle section, and then we have the last section. Okay? So, you know, this structure is something very important because whenever you write something, it has to be very clear. Now, here I say, remember what the Buddha said about the Dhamma. Adi kalyanam, majhe kalyanam, pariyosana kalyanam. I am sure you are familiar with that concept. About the Dhamma, Buddha says, what is this? Adi kalyanam, majhe kalyanam, pariyosana kalyanam. What is it? What is adi kalyanam? Dhamma is supposed to be adi kalyanam. Good at the beginning, right? Majhe kalyanam. Good at the middle. And pariyosana kalyanam. Good at the end. So, about the Dhamma, Buddha says, Dhamma is good at the beginning, good at the middle, good at the end. Now, you know, it's something very, very important and interesting. Now, when you think about the essay has to be Adi Kalyana, okay, Majhe Kalyana, and also Pariyosana Kalyana. You write something, it has to be good at the beginning, and it has to be good at the middle, and then also it has to be good at the end. Now, introduction and conclusion, upper part and the lower part. The purpose, saying at the start what you are going to do and saying at the end what you did, what do you have to do to do so? So why do you have to do so? Okay, the question is why? Now I say that, okay, introduction and conclusion. Beginning you say, what are you going to do? At the end you say what you did. Now why? You know, in a book or in a paper, sometimes, you know, you write a paper. But it is very important for you to say, what are you going to do in the paper? And then also at the end, you say what you did in the paper. Now, this is something very important. Sometimes there are so many papers, there are so many books. We don't have time to read all these things. How do we decide whether we should read something or not? You look at the beginning, you look at the end. At the very first paragraph or introductory chapter, you say, this is what I'm going to do. So this is interesting. So then you decide to read it. I mean, just to decide, you first look at the introductory chapter or introduction, or you look at the conclusion, see whether it is interesting. If you find it interesting, you read it. Otherwise, you don't read it. Introductory introduction or introductory section, when you say, this is what I'm going to do, then you can decide, okay, it's not relevant to me. So you don't read that. Oh, it is very important to me. Then you are going to read that. But you know, that particular thing at the very beginning is important. Then, you know, reader can know what you are going to do. This is what I'm going to do. And at the end, again, you say, this is what I did. Now, what is the importance of that? What is the importance of saying, this is what I did? Now, you know, in a paper, you start with saying, this is what I'm going to do. Now, at the end of it, again, when you say, this is what I did, you know exactly that you did what you promised at the beginning. Sometimes what happens is, you start by saying, I'm going to do this, but at the end, you have not done that. You know, this is an interesting and useful mechanism. You say by, okay, this is what I'm going to write. This is what I'm going to do. In this paper, I'm going to explain this. Or in this paper, I'm going to argue that this idea is wrong. Then at the end, you say, in this paper, I argued that this idea is wrong. So your beginning and your end has a connection. So someone who wants to read your paper, look at the beginning and look at the end, and then find it is, if it is interesting, that person will read it. Otherwise, not read it. So it is to have this structure very clearly is important for you, for the reader, and also it is important for you, because you start by saying, okay, I'm going to do this. And then you do it. And then finally you say, this is what I did. You know, that way it is a very, very methodical, structured effort. So you start here, introduction. You say, this is what I'm going to do. And this is how I'm going to do. And then here you say, this is what I did. I remember one of my professors, when he was teaching this, he gave a very interesting example. He said something like, you know, if you have a problem in your pipes in your home, then you bring a plumber to repair your pipe. And the plumber comes and examines, and, you know, he will tell you, okay, sir, this is what I'm going to do. I will fix here, I will put another part, and you know, he will tell you what he is going to do. And then he will do that, and then he will come back and say, okay, I removed this part, I put a new part, I did this, now pipe is working, so give me my payment, okay. But here you see, if you look at technically, very clearly, there is that plumber, beginning says, okay, this is what I'm going to do. And then he does it. And then he comes to you and say, okay, this is what I did. Okay? Now, it is like introduction is like plumber saying what he is going to do. Conclusion is plumber coming back and saying, okay, this is what I did. Middle part is plumber doing it. In the same manner, look at from that point of view, in the same manner, you say, this is what I'm going to write about. And then you say, this is what I did. Now, you know, in the academic writing, as I said here, you are trying to say something. You are trying to prove something. You are trying to explain something. And then you can do any of these things in this structure. Oh, you can say that in this paper, I'm going to explain the concept of vijnana in the Paticchasamuppada. And I'm going to use Pali discourses for that. So that's your introduction. And then you do that. After doing that, then again you conclude, you say, saying, in this paper, I described, I discussed, or I explained concept of vijnana in the Paticchasamuppada. And you conclude with that. So, you know, there is a clear beginning, clear middle, and clear end. So, whatever you write, whether you have, even if you write email or letter or anything, you have to have these three aspects. Okay? You are going, particularly when you are writing academic papers, or if you are writing a book, you have to follow this. Now, particularly if you look at a good book, books have introduction. Now, why do books have introduction? You know, just to give an idea. Now, look at Buddha's discourses. Look at Buddha's discourses. Now, in the discourses, Buddha starts, because I'm going to tell you this. So Buddha gives the basic idea at the beginning. And then Buddha describes that. Buddha starts by saying, because there are four types of people in the world. And then Buddha goes one by one by one by one. Four very clearly. And then you have a conclusion. You know, it's very interesting. If you look at the Dharma, Buddha's teaching, they are very methodical. That is one sense when Buddha says, Dhamma is Adi Kalyana, Majjhe Kalyana, Pariyosana Kalyana. When Buddha says that there are four different types of people in the world, Attantapo, Parantapo, and so on, Buddha gives the list, and then Buddha explains it methodically from the first, second, third, fourth. He doesn't start from the fourth and then jump into the third and going back to the first, you know, not like that. He will be describing it one, two, three, four, right? That is methodical. So, if you look at the sermons of the Buddha, you can see this. You know, they are methodical. That is why Buddha says it is Adi Kalyana, Majjhe Kalyana, Pariyosana Kalyana. You know, in fact, you know, the examples for academic writing you can find in the Buddha's discourses. Because Buddha was a very, very clear thinker. When your thinking is clear, your ideas are clear, if you know something clearly, you must be able to say it clearly. Sometimes we can't say clearly because we don't know clearly. If you don't know clearly, then you can't be writing clearly. But if you know something very clearly, so clear thinking is very important for clear knowing. If you have clear thinking and clear knowing, then, you know, clear writing is almost automatic, okay? So you have to have clear thinking. You have to have clear knowledge. And then if you follow this kind of structure, then, you know, your writing will be very, very clear. Now, you know, this exercise we are doing today is something very important for your whole life, okay? Now, this is important not only when you are writing, Suppose you are going and giving a Dhamma sermon. You have to have this structure. Dhamma sermon has to have this structure. Now, Buddha's sermons, Buddha's discourses have this structure. If you are going to give a Dhamma sermon, again you have to have a beginning, middle, and also end. When you are giving a Dhamma sermon, you just can't stop it, right? Then finally you say, okay, this is what I explained to you today, and you know, you summarize it, isn't it? Any successful Dhamma preacher begins by saying, okay, this is what I'm going to explain to you today. And then he will or she will explain it. And then finally there is a summary. Okay, this is what I said, these are the things I said. You summarize it. Right? So writing, giving speeches, all these things have to have this Adi Kalyana, Majhe Kalyana, Paryosana Kalyana. Okay? Keep that in your mind. And so whenever we are writing, and introduction and conclusion, because we say at the start what we are going to do, and then finally we say what we did, okay? Now, this basic structure is something very, very important when we talk about academic writing. Now, before going into presentation, in fact, I want to spend some time with you about argument, because I mentioned argument to you, and what is really an argument? Let me go briefly out of this and go into a different one. What is an argument? Okay, we will do a little bit of discussion and exercise on this. Argument is used in two senses. Now, I said to you, in an academic writing, basically what we are doing is we present arguments. Okay, we present arguments. Argument, this word is used in two senses. Dispute or disagreement with others expressed in harsh language. Number two is systematic presentation of reasons in order to prove one's own point or to disprove others' point. Now here, in ordinary language, we use this word argument in two different senses. Now, if I get into argument with you, means I am fighting with you, which is not very good. Okay? So, argument has a negative sense. Negative sense is, argument means arguing with somebody in harsh, not good language, you know, shouting at each other. So, we use this negative sense. However, academically speaking, there is a very positive sense of argument. Now, that positive sense is number two, systematic presentation of reasons in order to prove one's own point or disprove others' point. In the second sense, argument is the most important aspect of academic discussions. This is also called reasoning or logical reasoning. So, important thing is this, logical reasoning or reasoning, another word for argument. Now, when you say argument, argument is not a very good word sometimes, okay? But argument has an academic, philosophical sense, okay? So, logical reasoning or reasoning is what we are going to do. Reasoning means you give reasons. I mean, you say something and in order to establish it, prove it, you give reasons. Now, there is a methodical way to present reasoning. Now, this is what is called logical argument, okay? Now, this, in fact, you have to learn separately. I'm just going to give you only a brief idea today. But actually, logical reasoning is a different, separate thing. I'm sure you will be learning these things separately because, you know, it is important. All of us need to know how to argue, how to present argument. So logical reasoning. Now, as I said earlier also, you have to give reasons, otherwise people don't believe. Okay? If you are a dictator, you can say, okay, do this. But you know, in the ordinary society, we don't do that. We will ask why. Why do you have to do that? Then you have to give reasons. Even to a small child, they don't do things, you know, you ask them to do. They will ask why. Then you have to say, this is why you have to do it. Then, you know, it's a reasoning. So we are doing this in our daily life. But in the academic writing, you know, we need to do that. So the argument is a systematic presentation of reasons in order to prove one's point or to disprove the other's point. So in the second sense, this is the most important thing. This is called reasoning or logical reasoning. There are two forms of reasoning, inductive and deductive. The first is the method or the way of reasoning followed in natural sciences, although it may also be used in social sciences and humanities to some extent. Now here I use some words, natural science, social science and humanities. Actually those words refer to usually what we are studying in a university. Okay? When we say the word natural science, that means areas we study about nature. For example, natural science means chemistry, physics, zoology, biology, all these things about nature, about the world, about animals, about human beings. Now, all these things are natural sciences. Now, usually we use the word science for these things. Now, science means basically natural sciences. When we study chemistry, physics, zoology, botany, and in all these things. Botany means about plants, zoology means about animals, and so on. And about the astronomy, about the stars, and you know, things like that. So now natural sciences. Sometimes it may be also used in social sciences and humanities. Now the social sciences means like political science, sociology, anthropology, and you know, subjects like about society, political science, about society, those are called social sciences. And humanities means basically languages, religions, and things like that. Now, in here, what we study come under the section of humanities. When you study Buddhism, broad theme is, it comes under humanities. Humanities means subjects related to human beings. So if you study languages, languages are aspect of human behavior. So when we study languages, it is humanities. When we study religion, it is humanities. When we study culture, it is humanities. Okay? So basically in the university, we know that we study natural sciences or social sciences or humanities. And usually in universities, the places are called universities because all these things are taught in universities. Different students study these things. Now, if you look at logical reasoning, we have what is called inductive reasoning and deductive reasoning. Now, inductive reasoning is basically what is followed in natural sciences, okay? Inductive reasoning. Inductive reasoning or induction, we also use the word induction, is basically to look at the nature and look at particular things, individual things, and to draw some kind of general conclusions is what is happening with natural sciences, inductive reasoning. Actually, if you look at science, you can see this is inductive reasoning. Now, for example, I will give you a simple example to you. When we have fever, we go to a doctor and then doctor gives you some medicine. And suppose 25 people have fever, they go to the doctor, usually everybody gets the same medicine. Now, how do you know that this same medicine will work for all people? Now, that is what is called inductive knowledge. Because, you know, you look something to be applicable to larger number of people. So, doctors come to know that by doing this acquiring knowledge according to inductive reasoning. So, in science, usually you have inductive reasoning, general. Now, if you look at a motor car, vehicle, engine works in a similar way in all the vehicles, like that. So, you know, those are very general things. Now, you get general things by observing the nature. One very the easy example is we say all human beings die. We say all human beings die. Is that true? Okay. How do we know that? We have seen in the society, in the world, in different countries. So far, nobody is living 150 years. Okay? So, we say that all human beings die. But, we are all living here. But the idea is that someday we will be dying. So, that way we say all human beings die. But how do you know that? If you look at the past, if you look at everywhere in the world, you can see that everywhere in the world, people so far have died. Okay? So therefore you say all human beings die. Now that type of knowledge is inductive knowledge. We say all swans are white. How do we know that? Have you seen all swans? No. I mean there are so many countries in the world. We have not been to all these places, but so far, swans we have seen are all white. Nobody has seen a non-white swan. So therefore we say all swans are white. So that's the kind of what we call inductive knowledge, okay? That means we look at swans in Myanmar, swans in Sri Lanka, swans in other countries, every country swans are white. So therefore we say all swans are white. But of course, we know that there can be many places we have not seen. But when we say all swans are white, we say that even those places, swans should be white. So that is science. But you know, maybe somebody will find ultimately there is a swan which is not white. But then, it's not a big problem because for 99.9 cases, swans are white. Maybe one or two swans are not white. It's like when 25 people go with fever, doctor gives the same medicine. Maybe for one or two people, the medicine will not work. But then, medicine is still good. It works for 23 people. Only for two people, it did not work, right? So this is scientific knowledge, nature of the scientific knowledge. So this is we call inductive knowledge. However, what I'm going to discuss with you today is what we call deductive knowledge. Deductive or deduction. Deductive knowledge means logically you get something out of the things you already know. Now for example, let me give you an example. It will be easy to understand. Now I said, earlier, all human beings die. How do we know that? Because we see human beings die, and so we say all human beings die. Now, look at this logical statement. We say all human beings die. We say Socrates is a human being. Therefore, Now look at this. In the inductive reasoning, we started looking at each individual people, and then we found that so far people have died. So we come to the conclusion all human beings die. So we get this conclusion by induction. However, starting from this, we say all human beings die, and then we say Socrates is a human being, then we say Socrates dies. Now, you know, this conclusion, this is deduction. Why do we call it deduction? Because this conclusion we derive from these two premises. Okay? This conclusion, this is the conclusion here. Socrates dies. How do we know Socrates dies? Because number one is all human beings die and Socrates is one of the human beings. In fact, you know, we don't have to say this. When we say all human beings die, Socrates is a human being, then you know that's what it says. All human beings die, Socrates is a human being. So your conclusion is clear. Now that is what is called deduction. You deduce, you infer from those two statements your conclusion. So actually this is what we are going to do in deductive reasoning. This is the kind of thing we are going to do. We deduce or we infer the conclusion from these premises. Now let me introduce you a couple of terms we are using in this. So these two, we say premises. These two are premises. And then this is called conclusion. Okay? This is conclusion. These two are premises. Now, this is important. Based on the premises, we draw a conclusion. Now, this is what basically we are doing. Based on premises, we draw a conclusion. Now, what I wrote is formal type of argument, like, you know, basically you have two premises and one conclusion, okay? So based on these things, you derive this. So actually in a deductive argument, your conclusion is contained in your premises. When you look at the premises, your conclusion must be clear. Now let me give you a simpler example. Now this is mathematics. It's simply we say 2 plus 2 equals 4. But actually even if I didn't write 4, when you have this 2 plus 2, we know 4, right? It's pretty simple. But it is like this. Even if the mathematical thing is this chalkboard full, still you can work it out and then finally you can get the answer. Now that means that your conclusion is contained in the premises. Now this is the premise. This is the premise. Conclusion is this. Okay? Now this also is a deductive argument. Like this actually. It's like this. Because you have one premise here plus one premise here and your conclusion is 4. Same thing. All human beings are mortal. Die. Socrates is a human being, therefore Socrates dies. So in other words, you look at your premises and then you get your conclusion. Now you know this is basically a type of what we call argument. You give reasons. Now these are premises means you give reasons. And then based on the reasons, you say your conclusion. So how do you conclude that Socrates dies? Based on these two things. Okay, so the premises, in other words, we can say reasons. So we are using reasons, we are using premises, okay? Premises means reasons. Now, you know, this is one type of argument. Now, if you really look at this argument, you can see there is some kind of rationality, logical thinking behind this. Now we are talking about something like all human beings and, you know, it's something like this. Okay, now if we get this circle is, we say this circle is all human beings. Now, within this circle, this all human beings, you have Socrates. You have Socrates, we have Aristotle, you have all the other people within this, right? Within this circle. So, this circle is all human beings. And then, actually, this is what is called, usually what we have here is what is called class and member. Class and member. Now, we have a class of all human beings. In the class of all human beings, you have Socrates as one member. Right? So, within the class of human beings, you have one member. If you know something common to the class, that is common to the each and individual member of that class. Is that right? Okay. We say all parrots are green. So if we have a parrot, then parrot is green. Because that is the class of all parrots. And then any individual is a member of that class. So if the class has some characteristic, all the members have that characteristics. If we say something like all the students in Sitagu Academy are intelligent, so any student is intelligent, right? Because it's a member, it's a whole member, and then anyone in that class is, you know, intelligent. Because we attribute one characteristic to the whole class, then each member of that class has that attribute, right? So, in fact, when we say all human beings die, and then next we say Socrates is human, we are saying that whatever common to all human beings is also common to Socrates. Whatever common to the whole class of things is also common to the members. So, class and the member, that type of relationship, okay? And let me show you another type of argument, structure a little bit different from this. Then we will see what basically we trying to say in an argument. We say something like this. If the sky is dark, it will rain. If the sky is dark, it will rain. Will rain. Now you see here there is a little bit different type of thing, but again, if you look at carefully, we say if the sky is dark, then it will rain. We can say then. If the sky is dark, then it will rain. We say sky is dark, therefore we conclude it will rain. Now this is a different type of logical structure. But again, you can see that in this this type of argument, we have number one and then number two premise, and then this is conclusion. Now, this number one premise says that if the sky is dark, then it will rain. Number two says sky is dark. Actually, here we say therefore it will rain. Now, in other, you know, this again, you can see that. Some kind of, in a way, causal relationship, cause and effect type relationship you can see there, okay? So we say sky is dark, it will rain. And we say sky is dark, therefore it will rain. Now, you can see that there is again a method here. But suppose we have the sky is dark, it will rain, that's number one, okay? Look at this, okay? Number one, we say if, same thing, okay. it will rain. Now, here we, if we go to the other, so if it, if the sky is dark, then it will rain. Now, if you go to the other way around, actually, then we can see that you can't go other way around. Because if the sky is dark, then you can conclude that it will rain. Now, other way around, maybe not. But in order to show that, you know, simply we can say that it rains. And then we say, therefore, the sky is dark. Now, strictly speaking, simply because it's raining, we can't say sky is dark. Because there can be moments it rains, but the sky is not dark, actually. But this example is not very good for the other side. But if we can think about any other example, something like, if it rains, we can say that the river is full. And then we can say it rains, therefore river is full. But on the other hand, if we say if it rains, the river is full, the river is full, therefore it rains, it doesn't work. Because, you know, there can be some other reasons for the river to be full. So there can be some other reasons sky is dark. Simply it is raining, you can't say sky is dark. The sky can be dark simply because of smoke. But that doesn't mean it is, you know, the raining. So, you know, the other way around doesn't work that way. But here it is simply an argument. You can see different type of argument based on some kind of causal relationship. So I gave you, showed you two types of arguments here. Basically, one thing is class and member type thing and also causal thing. In either case, what we are going to do is basically we give premises and based on the premises, we give conclusions. Okay. Now, this is what we consider to be what we are going to doing with argument. So, the deductive argument is something we give premises and based on the premises, we draw conclusions. Okay. So, we will move on. Deduction is the formal logical method developed in the West initially by Aristotle and others up till now. In India, Hindu and Buddhist logicians developed deductive system, similar in some respect and different in others. I'm not going to describe these things. In a deductive argument, there is a conclusion, which is what the argument is trying to prove or establish, and premises to support that conclusion. Deductive argument is called syllogism, and a deductive argument consisting of categorical proposition called categorical syllogism. I'm not going to describe that either. In a standard argument with categorical propositions, there are three propositions, major premise, minor premise, and conclusion with terms. Okay, these are technical things which we don't need at this juncture. Now, for the three terms, the major term is the predicate of the conclusion, minor term is the subject of the conclusion, middle term occurs in the first two premises but does not occur in the conclusion. Example, all human beings are mortal, the same argument, mortal means they die. Socrates is human, therefore Socrates is mortal. In this example, mortal is the major term, Socrates is the minor term, the human is called the middle term, which does not occur in the conclusion. Now, basically, this is a fairly technical thing, which I don't have time to describe this morning, so I will skip that. Now, look at this. Logical arguments are not only about categorical propositions, they are also concerned about other types of statement. The categorical propositions are basically about classes. But statements such as, if the sky is cloudy, then it will rain, either X or Y will come, are not about classes. But combining such statement, logically valid conclusions may be drawn. Okay. Now, this is basically deductive argument, based on two premises, we draw a conclusion. However, in this class today, I'm not going to teach you logic, but what I'm going to discuss with you is how the logical reasoning can be used when we are writing our essays, okay? Now, this is basically what I'm going to do. Now, look at the third paragraph here. What we discuss up to this point is on formal logical argument. Now, these are kind of what we call formal logical argument. Formal means there is a structure. First premise, second premise, and the conclusion. So that structure is there. If you follow the structure, then the argument is correct, okay? But this formal aspect, I'm not going to discuss because, you know, we have to really do it slowly. But arguments are not formal always, okay? Now, for example, when I said, okay, so you say, okay, do this. Then other person asks, why? Then you give reasons. Actually, your do this is your conclusion there. After that, only you give reasons, right? So, when in our day-to-day life, in our speeches, in our writing, we don't follow exactly the same structure. In the arguments, structure can be different. Now, in academic paper, you start writing, in this paper, I'm going to say that this is this and this and this. So, start by saying your conclusion. That's perfectly okay. And then you start by saying your conclusion, and then you give reasons for that. Okay? So, although formal logical arguments are important, we have to study, but actually in our academic writing, we are not always using the formal arguments, but we are using arguments in an informal manner. Now, what are these informal arguments? What we discuss up to this point is on formal logical arguments. However, as scholars in humanities, what is equally or even more important is how to present sound, valid and true arguments in non-formal manner. In other words, how to present arguments in ordinary language will be of utmost importance for scholars in the academic writing. So for us, what is very important is to give arguments in a regular non-formal manner, okay? So, now when we look at good academic writing, we can always see non-formal type of argument. Now, if you look at the Buddha's sermons, Buddha's sermons are always, we can see there are arguments, okay? Now, for example, you know the statement, yada nicchang tang dukkhang, yang dukkhang tadanatta, right? Yada nicchang tang dukkhang, yang dukkhang tadanatta. We can say if something is anicca, then it is dukkha. If something is dukkha, then it is anatta. Okay? Yadanichang tan dukkhang, yang dukkhang tadanatta. Right? Clear? Okay. Now, based on this, although Buddha did not say this, can't we say this? If something is anicca, then it is anatta. What do you think about this? If something is anicca, then it is dukkha. If something is dukkha, then it is anatta. Then based on that we conclude, if something is anicca, then it is anatta. Right or wrong? Right. right or wrong? Actually, logically, it is correct. It is right. Because if you look at, if something is anicca, then it is dukkha. If something is dukkha, then it is anatta. Now, then we can get the conclusion. So logically, we can say something like, anicca, dukkha. Dukkha, anatta. So our conclusion is, anicca, anatta. Can you see now? Anicca, dukkha, dukkha, anatta. So therefore, in logic we say this, therefore. Therefore, if something is anicca, then it is anatta. Now you see, actually what the Buddha said is this, isn't it? All the impermanent things are dukkha and also all the impermanent things are anatta. Now, logically we can say that even without dukkha we can say if something is anicca, it is anatta, right? So here you can see the logical conclusion. Actually there is a logical rule behind it. Now, logical rule is we say P implies Q, Q implies R, therefore P implies R. The connection is P implies Q, Q implies R. Here you can see this is the connected thing. Therefore P implies R, same thing. Anicca dukkha dukkha anatta. So here dukkha. So anicca, from anicca to dukkha, dukkha to anatta. So therefore logically we can conclude from anicca to anatta. So this is basically, you can see the logical reasoning. And then you look at the reasoning in Paticca-samuppada. Actually Paticca-samuppada, the reasoning is this, isn't it? Avijjapachya sankhara, sankharapachya vijnana, vijnanapachya namarupa. Now, if you take all 12 go like this, then can't you conclude avidya pachya jati jara marana? Right or wrong? We can say avidya pachya jati jara marana. Is it wrong? I mean, it is logical because we can see the connection. Avidya pachya sankhara, sankhara pachya vijnana. Then vijnana pachya, you can see it goes like that. The connection is like anicca dukkha, dukkha anatta. So we have avidya pachya sankhara, then sankhara pachya vijnana, then vijnana pachya namarupa, namarupa pachya salayatana, salayatana pachya passo. So then we can say avidya pachya passo. Same thing. We can say avidya pachya namarupa. We can say avidya pachya jati jara marana. Actually the logical argument, but the connection is here, you see SS, VV, NN, SS. Can you see the connection? Because there is a continuity. Avidya pachya sankhara, sankhara pachya vijnana. Then vijnana pachya namarupa. So it goes vijnana pachya, then namarupa pachya salayatana, then salayatana pachya paswa, and so on. So you see actually this kind of logical reasoning, connectivity, connectedness, you can see in the Buddha's discourses. Okay? You can see these things in the Buddha's discourses. So what we need to do is, you know, we need to really look at these things and see how Buddha has really presented the argument. Okay? Now, in the discourses, when you read carefully, so we can see this connection in the discourses. Now when we are talking about the argument, it is very important for us to see valid and soundness of an argument. I think one of other discussions also I mentioned, but look at this carefully. A valid argument means an argument of which conclusion follows from its premises, or in which the conclusion is contained in the premises. Now you can see all human beings are mortal, Socrates is human, therefore Socrates is mortal. Now that is a valid argument, okay? But in a valid argument, the premises may not be true always. We can have a valid argument even with the false premises. When an argument is valid, but its premises are false, then it is not a sound argument. Soundness of an argument is sound when it is valid and premises are true. This interesting to see, because in logic, sometimes we can prove something which is not true. We can prove something logically, but it is not true. Now, let me give you a very mundane example. Suppose, somebody kills some person. That person who killed will go to lawyer and he will say to the lawyer, look, I killed this person, but you now protect me in the courts. So, he goes to the courts, and what happens is, if the lawyer is very good, that murderer person will be released. How? You show that, you prove that, or you show that this murderer really did not kill. But lawyer knows that he really killed him. You can't tell lies to the lawyer. You have to tell truth to the lawyer. You have to say, sir, I killed this man, but you now save me. Okay. Now, lawyer present arguments to prove that he did not kill. Now, what happens is here, argument is valid, but it's not logical. It's not true. But the law can't do anything, because according to law, if the argument is valid, then you accept it. But in the Dhamma, it is not like that. Okay? Even in the academic writing, it is not like that. Because if the argument is only valid, not true, then we don't accept it. So argument has to be both valid, that means logical, and also true. In other words, it has to follow a logical structure. Okay? And also it has to be true. Now if you take my example earlier, all human beings are mortal. Socrates is human, therefore Socrates is mortal. Now that is a true, valid and true argument. Because it's true that all human beings die. Okay? Now, we can have a false argument with the same valid structure. Now, look at this argument. We can say something like, all students in Sitagu, Mandalay are more than 60 years old. X is a Sitagu Mandalay student, therefore he is 60 years old. Now, that's a valid argument. But is that true? No student is more than 60 years here. But it is a logical statement, because we can logically prove it. If it is true that all the students in the Sitagu Institute are more than 60 years, then any and every student will be more than 60 years. So logically it is a valid argument. Although argument is logically valid, it is not true. Okay? So this validity and soundness of an argument is something very important for us here. So the valid argument is basically conclusion follows from the premises. Now it is like this. I showed you 2 + 2 = 4. Even if you don't see 4, you know this is true. Because these are the premises and this is the conclusion. But follows means when you look at the premises, you must be able to see the conclusion. It's like this. When you see 2 + 2, you see 4. It doesn't have to be mentioned separately. Same thing, when you say all human beings are mortal, Socrates is human, then you know that Socrates is mortal too. So that is validity. However, the premises also have to be true, and then only it becomes a sound argument. Okay. Now I refer here one instance where Buddha refers to 4 questions of argument. Sutakkitan tata, sutakkitan anyata, duttakkitan tatha, duttakkitan anyata. I'm not going to go into detail, but this is a very interesting thing. I think this comes in the Sangharava Sutta in the Majjhima Nikaya, where Buddha says, sutakkitan tata, well argued, true. But sutakkitan anyata means well argued, false. That means you can argue very well, but it's false. Then third is duttakkitantata. Your argument is weak, but it is true. And then duttakkitam anyatha, your way of argumentation is bad also, it is also false. Now these four positions. Now this may be, that is why Buddha described Dhamma as Dhammo Gambhiro Duddhaso Atakka Vacharo. Atakka Vacharo. Because this takka can be true or false. So Buddha says that you can't go by only the takka. You can't go by only logic, right? Because simply something being logical means something valid. But that doesn't mean it is true. Okay? So it's important for us to have both validity and the soundness of an argument. That means you argue something, but it has to be true. In a non-formal argument, it's not necessary to have exact number of premises. One can have any number of premises for one or several conclusions. In such a situation, what is considered to be a premise may not be just one sentence. It may be a paragraph or several paragraphs or even a chapter serving as a premise. In reading an academic or any text, it is very important to identify premise or premises and conclusion or conclusions. Unlike in a formal argument, in an informal argument, in ordinary language, there is not fixed place for the conclusion or premises. They can be anywhere in the essay depending on the writing style of the author. Now this section is very important for you, because when you are making an academic essay, we are not really talking about this kind of structured arguments. We are talking more on arguments which are presented in day-to-day language. Like I said, when you start writing a paper, you start saying, in this paper, I am going to prove that this is wrong. So actually, you start by saying your conclusion. You start by saying your conclusion. And then you give premises to support it. Maybe again in the concluding section, you say, in this paper, what I did is to support or prove or disprove this or something. So you can see in an informal argument, but academic writing, in order to prove a point, you have to give reasons. Now each reason, suppose in order to prove something, you give three reasons. Each reason you describe in three paragraphs. So each paragraph can be considered a premise, reason, okay? So what I'm really trying to do is this. Now ultimately, when you write paper, academic paper, ultimately your paper must be able to summarize into several sentences, okay? You can say that, look, I'm going to do this. Now that's your conclusion. And then you give the reasons. Maybe you write a whole chapter. But then whole chapter, you can see there are three or four or five reasons. In other words, what is very important is, as young scholars, when you read something, say when you read a paper, always try to see what are the main points. Okay? You ask the question, what is he saying? What is his main idea? Okay? Now, his main idea is the conclusion. Okay? And then you look for why. What is the reason? Why does he say so? Then you look at the reasons. Like, then it becomes very, very clear in your mind. Otherwise, 10-page paper is very long. But if you read it carefully, you get the main point, and then you sort it out. Okay, this is what the author wants to say. And in order to say that, he gives this and this and this and these reasons. Right? So do that exercise. Whenever you read the book, whenever you read the paper, just see what is he doing? What is he saying? Sometimes you will see not saying anything. It's true. Some people don't have anything to say. They just keep on writing, talking. It's the same thing with the talk. Sometimes somebody can give a 1-hour talk. Then friend asks, what did he say? Nothing. What does it mean? Maybe he didn't say anything important. But 1 hour talk or half an hour talk, you can give a talk to prove something, establish something. In a Dhamma sermon, you can say, in this Dhamma sermon, I will be describing to you Paticchasamuppada today. So maybe 1 hour you talk about Paticchasamuppada. That's very clear. But you start saying, I'm going to talk about Paticchasamuppada, but you talk about something else, then what happens? You don't have a clear conclusion there, okay? So in the academic writing, this argument aspect is something very, very important. You can see that Buddha always tried to prove a point. Now he gives reasons in order to prove it. Okay? If you look at very carefully the discourses, you can see that Buddha gives points. Prove it. And then you can see that reasoning is there. So what I am telling is not something new, okay? Because you have to present it in the methodical manner and prove your point. Okay, as an exercise, you look at Dhamma, for example, Dhamma Chakka Pavattana Sutta. If you look at the sutta, the structure is very clear. Start from, and then this thing, go to the dukkha, samudaya, nirodha, magga. Very clear. So you can write a structure within just few sentences. So any discourse of the Buddha has a very clear structure. Beginning, middle, and end. Okay? Because as I said, when your thinking is very clear, your writing becomes also very clear. But if your thinking is not very clear, then your writing can't be clear. Okay, I'm going to wind up this discussion. What I try to tell you is this. In academic writing, there is a beginning, there is a middle, and also there is an end. Okay, so this structure is very important, and it has to be clear. And then in the middle, in the content, we give reasons in order to prove reasoning, okay? Now, what are the reasons? Now, how do we give the reasons? Now, basically reasoning is, logical reasoning is, you know, where we give, formulate our reasons. Now, this last, plate of my presentation is to show you in our academic writing, as in a formal argument, there is no clear-cut number of premises or conclusion. In a regular argument, two premises, one conclusion. But it's not like that actually academic writing. You can draw any number of conclusions, and also you can give any number of premises in order to support it. Any successful academic writing has this kind of structure. All right, I will follow up in the afternoon session. Do you have any questions or comments about the things we discussed up to this point? Any questions? Yes, sir. You mean how to decide what is good? Okay. Actually, thank you. What I mean by the good at the beginning, good at the middle, and the good at the end means in this context. Now, when we talk about Dhamma, it is one thing, okay? But I took only the idea from the Dhamma. But when it comes to essay, beginning, middle, and end, good means clear. That is the idea. It's clear to the reader. So from the beginning, it is very clear. It's also logical. That is what I mean. But when it comes to the Dhamma, Buddha said, Adi Kalyana, Majje Kalyana, Pariyosana Kalyana, it is little bit different. But you know, this idea also we can understand in somewhat different manner. So in the academic writing, beginning good means you are very clear at the beginning. Middle good means your reasoning is very clear. Again, good at the end means you make a summary and summarize, and it is also properly done. So that is the clarity, and the methodicalness is what is meant by good. Okay, that is basically what we mean by academically good thing. So in academically good writing, things are very clear. That's what it means. Okay. Okay. If you have any questions, you can also ask me afternoon if you have not formulated your questions. All right. So we will wind up the morning discussion from this, and we will continue in the afternoon. Okay. Thank you very much.